going to the book of Luke, chapter number 6. Luke chapter number 6. I want to read starting at verse number 6. Amen. If you have Luke 6, would you say amen?
Amen.
If you don't have it yet, just say hold on just a minute. I promise y'all, I really feel like preaching tonight. I think I'm probably going to end up doing a mixture of preaching and teaching at the same time. But there's power in this room right now. Luke chapter number 6, verse number 6 reads like this. And it came to pass also on another Sabbath that he entered into the synagogue and taught. And there was a man whose right hand was withered. And the scribes and the Pharisees watched him, whether he would heal on the Sabbath day, that they might find an accusation against him. But he knew their thoughts and said to the man which had the withered hand, rise up and stand forth in the midst. And he arose and stood forth. Then Jesus said unto them, I'll ask you one thing. Is it lawful on the Sabbath to do good or to do evil, to save life or destroy it? And looking round about them all, he said unto the man, stretch forth thy hand. And he did so, and his hand was restored whole as the other.
Amen.
For just a few moments for your consideration, I feel like preaching tonight, y'all. I feel something on me. God have mercy. Would you look at somebody and tell them these words? Say, neighbor.
Neighbor.
Come on, say it with authority and a bully and say,
neighbor,
I refuse
to live
with a withered hand.
Come on.
Look at somebody else on the other side and testify to that other neighbor and say,
neighbor,
I refuse
to live
with a withered hand. You can be seated in the presence of the Lord. Hallelujah. Glory to God. I refuse to live with a withered hand. I was on the thing that made this, I was about to say it a moment ago, but the thing that makes this so interesting is because I had to preach a homegoing service, or as most people call it, a funeral service, but when saints die, we don't have funerals.
Amen.
Hello?
Amen.
When saints go home to be with the Lord, we don't have funerals, we have homegoing celebrations. So a lady went home to be with the Lord. She was 97 years old, and I preached her homegoing today. And so I've been asking God, you know, I said, God, what am I supposed to say tonight? I need you to talk to me about tonight. I got today down. What am I supposed to say tonight? And I spent all this time thinking and praying, and nothing came.
Come on.
Nothing came.
Come on.
I would love to say that God's just been talking to me all week and doing all this. He has not.
Come on.
Do you know it was on my way here tonight?
Praise the Lord.
I'm driving down the road and I'm on my way here.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden, God starts talking.
Yeah.
And I said, okay. And it was at that moment that I knew what God wanted to say.
Praise
to
the
me.
Lord. Praise the Lord.
And it began like this. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I travel quite a bit preaching the gospel. And I go and I do a lot of revivals, if you will. And the thing that is most disturbing to me is that as I go across the country preaching, as I walk in these services, and so few people have a notepad.
Yeah.
So few people bring their pen.
Yeah.
So few people, and I know we're in an electronic age now. So people are bringing their, you know, they have their tablets, their iPads, so on and so forth. But so few people are actually taking the time to take notes on what's being said.
Amen. That's right.
Oh, it's gonna get tight in here.
Come on.
I want to say to everybody in this room, do not ever come into the house of the Lord again without having something in your hand that allows you to take notes and to receive what God is saying. Because you know what? You know what, ladies and gentlemen, no matter how good, how powerful you are, how great of a memory you have, something is going to be said in the course of the Word of God that you might not need right now.
That's right, amen.
Hello, somebody. Y'all can talk to me here tonight. Something is going to be said in the Word of God that you might not need right now. Down the road, you may need it just a little bit later. And I don't care how good your mind is, you're going to need to have it written down or have it put down somewhere, because you're not going to remember it in the moment when you need it the most. Help me preach in here, Holy Ghost. Part of the problem is, as believers, we find ourselves thinking we got it all together, but it's only the Word that you rehearse over and over and over again that is the Word that's going to come alive in the moment when you need it the most. Rehearsed over and over. Okay, let me go to Joshua chapter 1, verse number 8. He says, in this law shall you meditate day and night. The word meditate literally lends itself to this thing called muttering. It lends itself to the connotation of muttering. It means to repeat over and over and over and over and oh God, one of the reasons why we got to keep running the church service after church service looking for the next great experience is because we need to hold on to what we had in the first place.
Yeah,
that's it.
Come on, brother.
Yeah, that's good.
That's right.
God, I feel good here.
Yeah.
Scripture says, thy word have I hidden in my heart that I might not sin against thee. It takes some work to get that word hidden in your heart. There's too many people who are surface believers. You get a word and it sits on the surface. But then the Bible says that the fowls of the air come and eat the word up from your life. The word is a seed, and the devil is sending a fowl of the air. He's sending trouble. He's sending trial. He's sending tragedy to come and eat up that word out of your heart. He's sending all kind of stuff to eat that word up out of your heart, ladies and gentlemen.
That's good.
That's why you cannot afford to let the word just stay on the surface of your life.
Amen.
Am I preaching all right so far? Where we have been. We don't have a powerful church anymore.
Come on.
All we got is people who get high.
Yeah. Come on, that's right. Preach it.
We have people who are looking to get high.
Yeah.
If you come in here and I don't preach well enough to give you a feeling, you say, well, I got to go back to another sermon. He didn't give me a feeling. Baby, why are you trying to get a feeling all the time? Don't feel anything.
Amen.
Woo!
Amen.
Sometimes when he's at work, you're not going to feel anything. You know, we get all excited when we have the Holy Ghost goosebumps, and we get all excited when we have the shimmy and the shake. Ladies and gentlemen, I come to tell you, you got to quit looking for a shimmy, quit looking for a shake, quit looking for goosebumps, because God is trying to get you to a place where you have power. Trying to work something in your life that has some depth. See, the problem is we're so busy trying to get high, we don't know what it means to have depth anymore. We don't know what it means to put that word deep. We're struggling. And we're not a powerful people. We're only as powerful as the last message we heard.
Come on.
Oh, Lord.
Come
Because when your baby gets sick, you don't have enough power to go in your own cabinet and grab your own bottle of olive oil. You all on Facebook telling everybody else to pray for you. You don't even know how to stand up against the enemy for yourself and say, devil, you can't have my baby. You got everybody else praying, but you don't have anything under your belt for you to pray with. God have mercy. Ah, the Bible says, now unto him who is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that you ask or think, according to the power that's at work in you. The problem is, we don't have any power at work in us, so he can exceed it and go abundantly above it. We talk about according to the power that's at work in you. Ask your neighbor, what's working in you right now? What's working in you? What's working in you? What's working in you? Working in you? What's working in you? We have a struggle, ladies and gentlemen, because we have become a powerless church. The first thing that stood out to me about this text, ladies and gentlemen, was that they were in, it was a Sabbath day, and they were in the synagogue. It was a Sabbath day, and they were in the synagogue. The man with the withered hand came to church. Now, I'm just wondering. Text doesn't say this. Matter of fact, it doesn't have to. I see it now. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Here's the thing. Number one, it was obvious that he had a withered hand. Part of the reason, I don't know who I'm talking to right here. Part of the reason you can't get your miracle is because you're so busy trying to hide the condition in your life. I come to tell you, if you're going to get healed, you got to stop trying. Trying to hide your condition. But I come to tell you, the reality is, there's coming a point in your life where there's some stuff you ain't going to be able to hide anymore. Oh God. Listen, I can tell when some people got some stuff that's withered if I sit around you long enough and listen to you talk. Ah, you may have gone through whatever you went through 3 years ago, 5 years ago, and if that's still your conversation, it's obvious something is still withered in your heart. No matter how you try to cover it up, no matter how you try to block it up, you can't cover it, you can't hide it, because sooner or later, it's going to show. Withered hand. We don't know.
Come on.
We don't know. Lord, it's getting good to me already. I have in my life run into people who had hands that were like this. They were, one hand was full. One hand was withered because they were underdeveloped. Many of them that I've seen whose hands were withered because they were underdeveloped was because they didn't stay in long enough. Y'all not talking back to me over here. They didn't stay in the process long enough. They didn't stay in development mode long enough. Part of our problem is some of us are so anxious to get out of whatever we're going through. We don't understand that God allowed you to get out of it so you can go through.
I'd rather you develop me fully, God, and let me develop right than for me to try and impress people with how my gifts are. Because if I come out too soon, and if I come out underdeveloped, then what happens is I'm off balance. Part of me works well, but the other part is with
it. Yeah, amen.
Woo! Woo! Part of me is working real good, but part of me is with it. Lord have mercy. And so, I need to challenge somebody. Stop asking God to bring you out before time. Learn, y'all do know that when a baby is in the womb, it goes through a lot in the womb. It might be cradled, it might be comfortable in the womb. There's a whole lot of stuff that goes on in the womb. But that's because it has to go through the entire process of development. We don't know whether the man was underdeveloped.
Come on.
I'm just offering options tonight. Can I just offer options?
Yes, yes.
He could have come out too soon, and so now his hand is withered because he's underdeveloped.
Yes, amen. Amen.
I would to God that we would get to a place where the church would become, oh Lord.
Come on.
Oh Lord.
Come on, man.
People get so out of order now. Lord, I feel the apostle coming up in me now. I feel it. Because, see, people get mad when you start disciplining them and telling them to come into order. Churches get started because folk don't want discipline. And the problem is, you reproduce your dysfunction when you have not been properly developed. When you get mad and leave your church and go either find another church or start your own church because you feel like they don't understand me over here. With underdeveloped. And the problem is, it can become genetic and you keep producing underdeveloped stuff.
Amen.
If you go, can I help somebody right here? If you go into battle with a withered hand, you're not going to be able to even one the other. You're either going to be able to hold the sword or the shield. You can't hold both of them when you're underdeveloped.
Amen. That's good.
You can, okay, in other words, you can preach good, but you don't have any faith.
Yeah.
Amen. Or all you got is just a little bit of faith, but you don't have any power to use the word against the enemy.
Come on.
That's
good.
Hallelujah. So, y'all can let me preach tonight. Like
yeah,
I feel
come
like,
on.
I'm telling y'all, I'm feeling it here tonight.
Yes, amen.
God, we got people who get mad. They go start their own church.
Yeah.
Cause you didn't let me do what I wanted to do in church.
Come on.
Can I go deeper?
Yeah.
You don't want anybody to tell you no.
Well,
I feel like the Lord is telling me to do this, this, and this. And your leader says, no, don't do that. No, don't do that doesn't necessarily mean not ever. It just means not now. Well, he doesn't know what God told me. Well, if you trusted him, if God spoke to you and told you to be a part of that ministry and you're supposed to be there, you need to obey those that have rule. Oh, God, y'all have to come here. You need to obey them that have rule over you. If you can't trust the leadership you're under, you need to go back to God and find out whether you're under the right leadership. And just because they tell you no doesn't mean they're not the right leadership. Sometimes you got to sit back and be quiet for the season that God has you silent. For the vision that he put in your life.
Hallelujah.
Glory to God. Woo. Hallelujah. Praise
you, Jesus.
Lord have mercy. We don't like folks to tell us no.
No, we don't.
We don't like for people to call us into order.
That's right.
I remember one night I was in a service, and the power of God was flowing. It was my time to get up to preach, and I'm up. And I've read the scripture, and I'm ready to preach. And this lady came down the little side aisle. She felt like she had a word from God to give to one of the people that was sitting on the front row. Now, first of all, number one, she's a lay member. And the people on the front row were leaders. Let me just help somebody with a little bit of order. I understand you may have a word from God, but you don't just walk up on leaders and tell them, I got a word for you.
Come on.
There's such a thing as order and protocol.
Yes.
If you feel like that you got a word for, now let me tell you how we were trained.
Come on.
I'm gonna help somebody right here. Let me tell you how we were trained.
Yeah.
If you felt like you had a word from God for a leader who was a guest of your pastor or your leader, you went to your pastor first and said, Pastor, I feel like I have a word from God for this person. Do I have your release to share it with them?
Yeah.
And my pastor was like this. Tell me what you feel like God said. Because if you're just developing in the things of God and developing in the prophetic, you need somebody who can judge that word and make sure that it's the right word for the right time. Releasing words on folks.
Amen.
Your gift and your word has to be proven.
Amen.
Oh, this is not comfortable for somebody right now.
Bless him, Lord. Bless him, Jesus.
I would rather have somebody prove the word and test the word that I'm releasing to make sure, watch this, not just that it is the word of God, but admit that it's the right timing to release it. Because some things, it's not the timing to say. It might very well be the word of God, but it might not be the timing.
Amen.
And when you get, have you ever had a piece of fruit that was not ready yet?
Amen.
Didn't taste that good and was not good for anything.
Amen.
That's right.
Amen.
Woo! I promise I'm coming up the hill about that withered hand, but I gotta get right here and work a little bit.
Bless you, Lord.
So this lady comes up to the front row and she just starts talking to a leader. Now, I made her a little mad because I stood right there on the platform and said, hey, mother, not now.
Yeah.
And she came out the service and said, well, my Lord Jesus wouldn't embarrass me like that. I said, yes, he would when you're out of order.
Amen. Come on.
Yeah.
I did it with love.
Amen.
I said, mother, not now. Can't do it now. Maybe later. Not now. And another thing, I'm going to drop this right here. Another thing, when we were trained, after we went to our leader and our leader gave us the release to go share the word, we still went to the person and said, man of God, woman of God, may I feel like the Lord's giving me a word for you. May I have your permission to release that to you?
Amen.
We didn't just walk up laying hands on leaders.
Come on.
We didn't just walk up laying hands on you. You don't do that.
Come on.
That's out of order.
Amen.
You have to honor leadership in the house of God.
Amen.
So you ask permission. When I go into a church, I don't care if I'm an overseer. That means I oversee pastors. But when I walk into somebody's church, I ask their permission. May I pray for you? May I lay hands on you? As powerful and as anointed as I might be, I still ask permission if I can pray for you. Because it's order.
Amen.
But people don't want that anymore. Let me get back
come
to this.
On,
y'all tighten
up
on now. Oh, Lord, I'm upsetting something good.
Come on.
Good.
Bless him, Jesus.
Because, see, we've been doing stuff just to be doing stuff for so long.
Yeah, that's right.
It's time for the house of God to line up. If we start getting back to a place where the house of God begins to line up, we'll start seeing more power released in the house of God. You can't give a private general responsibilities.
That's
you can't
right.
give a private captain's responsibilities because a private has not been in that thing long enough to have the experience to know how to work it.
Amen. Amen.
Hello, somebody.
Yes, amen.
Okay. So, we are both to get mad over stuff. It shouldn't be mad about.
because they can't have their way. Okay, this is good right here. That's a sign that you're withered.
Well,
that's a sign that you're underdeveloped.
Yeah.
Because you're mad, cuz. While I'm in it, can I dig a little deeper?
Oh,
why? Sometimes you're mad at your husband.
Come on.
Because your husband says no.
Yeah.
We're not going to do that right now.
Come on.
Well.
Come on.
Oh, Lord.
Come on.
You say God made him. You say you agree with the Bible. He's supposed to be the head of the household.
Amen.
And if he says we're going to wait a while before we do that, now you get mad.
Come on.
If God uses that man of God to say no, you need to learn what it means to submit and quit tripping, quit getting all upset, quit going to the store, buying that dress, hiding in the closet. Lord have mercy. And because the Bible says submit yourselves one unto another. Brothers, sometimes when the wife says, babe, I don't know if we ought to do that, you need to stop being so prideful and listen to her. It's a sign that you are withered when you can't listen to the wisdom of your wife.
Yes,
oh, I'm preaching good right there. I ain't got enough good amens.
Amen.
But hopefully you married a godly woman.
Yeah.
So if you married a godly woman, if she's sharing some wisdom, you have enough sense to listen and don't be prideful about what she's saying.
Yes, amen. Amen. Yes, amen.
Woo! I feel like my bishop. I know it's going to be this good. But we've got problems because we're walking around with her. I don't know if the man was underdeveloped.
Come on.
Or, oh Lord. I've been around some people who have had strokes.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the things generally I've seen with some people who've had strokes is they have their hands get twisted. And they don't have control over their hands. At best, their abilities with that hand is limited.
Yeah, that's right. Amen.
Anybody ever been around a stroke patient?
Yes.
And it has affected their hand?
Amen.
So, we got a problem. When it begins to affect your hand, and this is one of the points God told me to bring out tonight. Point number two, first one was we end up off balance.
Yeah.
One's working, one's not.
Yeah.
Second problem is we have an inability to hold on to things.
Yeah, amen, amen. Yes, amen.
Let me let that sink in for a minute.
Yeah.
We have an inability to hold on to things. I said earlier, we come to church and we get a good word.
Yeah.
We get excited.
Yeah.
We roll on the floor.
Yeah.
We fall out.
Yeah.
We shout. We dance. We clap. We do all that good stuff. We eat coming in a Honda.
Yeah.
Leave it in a Chevy. We tie my yellow bow tie.
Yeah, come on.
And when we get done with all of that, we're still walking around with an inability to hold on to what we got.
Yeah.
We have an inability to hold on to what we have.
Yeah,
amen.
Jesus,
Jesus,
Jesus.
Come on, come on.
Oh, God. Let me, can I work tonight?
Yeah, come on.
We're going to pretend like this is a shovel.
Come on.
If my hand is withered. Now, anybody that's ever done agriculture, you know you need your shovel and your hoe in order to get the ground ready to put seed in.
Yeah.
Amen.
Am I talking here?
Yeah.
You need your shovel or your hoe to put to get the ground right. So you can put seed in.
Yeah. That's right.
But if your hand is withered, you can't grip.
That's right.
Come on.
Mm-hmm. Come on. Yeah. Come on. Yeah.
You can't hold on to the thing that's going to cause you to get a harvest.
Yes. Yes.
Preacher will get up and give you a good word. But you can't hold on to the thing that's going to help you to prepare for your harvest. Not only can you not hold on to it, you can't grip it so you can use it properly to get the job done.
That's good.
Yes.
That's good.
Jesus.
That's good.
It looks funny for me to be holding this shovel like this, doesn't it? And I can't do anything with it but do like this. So watch. Now, anybody that knows anything about gardening, you do things in a straight line. There's that word order again. You do it in a straight line. Well, if I have no control.
Come on.
I have difficulty getting some things straight.
Yes, amen. Amen. That's good. Yes, amen.
If I have no control, I have difficulty getting some things straight.
Yeah.
I hear God saying tonight, it's time for somebody to come out of the place of having a withered hand, because I need you to be able to get some things straight in your life. But if I'm prepared to release a blessing, I need you to get some stuff straight in your life so that you will be prepared for the blessing.
Yes, amen. Yes, amen. Listen,
I'm reminded
Come on.
Of the text that says, I'll give you houses that you did not build.
Amen.
I'll give you vineyards that you did not plant. Now what that means is somebody else had a hand that was working. So because they had a working hand, they were able to till the ground so that you could step in to the thing that was prepared for you. Ladies and gentlemen, you ought to get ready, because you're about to step into something that God used somebody else to till the ground for. Ladies and gentlemen, it's not enough for you to step in to the ground that somebody else tilled. It's not enough for you to step into the place of the vineyard that you didn't have to plant, because if your hand is still withered when you get there and the harvest is waiting, you won't be able to hold on. Because when I think about a stroke victim, it means that something happened in their brain. That their brain was affected. Tonight I came to preach to somebody, because sometimes you can go through so much stress that stress can cause you a stroke.
Come on.
much stress that your brain can't take it, and it goes into overload, and you go into a stroke. I'm not just talking about in the natural, but I'm even talking in the spirit. You've been going through so much, you've been walking through so much, and you have not taken it. Oh, I heard my grandmama now. Take your burdens to the Lord and leave them there. Sometimes your blood pressure gets too high. It can send you into stroke level. More blood is trying to flow through than your arteries will allow. It means your blood vessels are constricting. Your ability to carry life. Y'all do know what the life is in the blood. I can't give you help in here. Your ability to carry life has been restricted because your blood vessels in the spirit have been constricted. But I came tonight with a balloon to open up your blood vessels. Somebody in here, you've been in a position where you felt like you were spiritually at stroke level. Well, I'm calling you down from stroke level. You're not going out of here. You're not becoming dysfunctional in the spirit, in the name of Jesus.
Yes, amen.
Yes.
Bless you,
Lord. Bless you, Jesus. Have your way.
My God. Stroke level. Stress.
Come on.
Built up.
Yes. Uh-huh.
Why
yes.
Have you been carrying what you've been carrying? Because you don't trust him.
Come on.
Like you say you do.
Come on.
I can't hear anybody tonight. If I ask you, do you trust him? Everybody in here will say, yeah, I trust him. That's your good working hand talking. But what about the hand that's not working too well?
Come on.
We struggle to grab a hold to trusting him.
Yeah, amen.
Amen. That's right.
What if,
oh Lord
Jesus, what if I had to be like Abraham?
Come on.
And he tells me to go somewhere I don't even know where I'm going. Can I grab a hold to what he says? Or am I walking around with well, let me I ain't rushing this tonight. I'm a woman.
No, come on.
Praise the Lord.
I feel this. Because somebody's getting some help tonight.
Amen.
Somebody in here is getting some help tonight.
Yes, amen.
Because you are going to walk out of here and say, I refuse to live with a limp or withered hand another day of my life.
Amen. That's right.
Yes, Lord.
Stroke will cause that hand. Watch this. Sometimes it's because the connection between the brain and the limb, it's not getting a proper signal.
Yeah.
How many of us in our lives right now, we've been to church, we've heard the preacher, but somehow when it comes between the difference of the hearing it, getting it here, and getting it to work here, something's missing. Stroke victims in the church.
Yeah.
withered hand. Hand. I can't quite do what I need to do. Can't make music that well. Because my fingers don't work like they're supposed to. Can't dig. Oh God.
Come on.
Okay. I need to go here. Because the Lord told me I need to make sure I get this right, right down into. See, and what happens is, he told me, he said, a sign that there are withered hand people in the church is that you'll come to church and you'd rather hear the preacher preach to you.
Come on.
But you won't go search out the scriptures yourself.
Come on. Come on. Come on.
That's the truth.
Come on.
That's the truth.
Y'all not talking?
Yeah, come on. It's true. It's true.
Oh, I'm getting in real trouble right here. What is it about us that loves the spooky stuff?
Oh, come on.
Nope, not me.
That's right. Come on.
Yeah. Not me.
You want the prophet to come in and be a soothsayer.
Come on, brother. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Oh, come in and tell me my business, brother. Read my mail.
Come on.
How about you read the book? See, I'm tired of raising up spiritually withered folks.
Yeah, amen.
Amen.
That's it.
People don't pick up their Bibles.
Come on.
They'd rather us come in and give them this spooky stuff.
Yeah.
Oh, he didn't even know that about me. He walked in here and he just saw all that red mama's. And I'm not against the prophetic. But oh, yes, Lord. See, remember I talked about that out of balance?
Yeah. That's right.
Out of balance folk are always running to something that excites them. Yeah. They're always running to the prophetic stuff.
Yeah,
well, I'm going to the next prophetic meeting.
Yeah.
I'm going to go to this prophetic meeting.
Yeah, that's right.
Oh, I'm going to go to this prophetic meeting. And we go to prophecy after prophecy after prophecy after prophecy, and you're still walking around.
Mm-hmm.
Yep,
that's it.
Mm-hmm.
Amen.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Have your way, Lord. Yes.
You got all these great words, but you're walking around.
Mm-hmm. That's it. Yes. Amen.
And we love this stuff.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, see.
Yeah.
My Bible says, study to show yourself. Okay, let me break it down. Study so you can have a working hand.
Yes, amen, amen, amen.
Study so you can have a working hand.
Yeah.
Part of the problem is, watch this. Proof of our withered nature is that because we don't understand it, we're afraid to study.
Yes, amen. Amen. What hold us back ourselves.
Well, I don't know anything about all that, so I don't know if I'm going to mess with that yet. I'm not mature. Oh, baby, when you going to get mature enough?
Oh, yeah.
If you would never learn algebra if you never took the time to go sit in the class.
Amen.
Yes, you had to learn your ABCs, your 1, 2, 3s. You had to learn about multiplication. You had to learn about addition in order for you to get to algebra. But there came a point where you could not do elementary school stuff anymore.
Amen.
What?
Come on.
What would it look like if you are a 12th grader and they're still repeating over and over to you, 1 + 1 = 2.
Amen.
2 + 2 = 4.
That's right.
4 + 4. This is what the church looks like.
Yes, it is.
That's
okay.
Right.
Let me move.
Bless him, Lord.
Help him, Jesus. Bless
him,
Lord.
Yes. I noticed the first thing. He was in church.
Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh. Couldn't hide his condition.
Yeah.
Because everybody noticed he had a withered hand.
Yeah.
Jesus noticed it.
Yeah.
The religious folk noticed it.
Yeah.
The priests of the temple noticed it.
Yeah.
Everybody noticed he had a
withered hand.
Now, I don't have time to deal with them getting mad about it. That ain't what I come here to deal with tonight.
Listen.
I came here to deal with the fact that he had. He was in church.
Uh-huh.
Now, obviously, if he was in church, this wasn't the first time.
Yeah, I mean.
But this was the time.
Come on, come on. Come on.
This was the time.
Yes.
He was in church. And the presence of God was there. This was the time that he showed up and the real power was there. Now they've been having church all this time and he could never get free from his withered hand, but this time about our own blessing, but can you shout? Can you praise God? I feel the anointing down in my toes. I feel the power flowing in this room. It's happening now. It's happening now. It's happening now.
He got called out.
Yes.
I can't get no help in here. There's no real rhyme and no real reason why we would think he would be calling us front and center. You look at yourself in the mirror and you say, Lord, I don't have a Coke bottle figure like the rest of them. Why do you want to call me? I don't know.
Can I preach like I'm feeling it?
I don't speak all eloquent. I'm just a little country girl. But oh, why would you call me front and center? But I need them to see I can take a country girl and use a country girl for my glory. There's no real reason why he should have called none on you. There's no real reason why he should have called none on you. There's no real reason why he should have called none on you. But what you didn't understand is that he had a plan.
Ladies and gentlemen, we're going.
can't get no help on here. For the rest of my life, I'm going to stretch out. I won't be depressed for the rest of my life. I'm going to. Can y'all take a little bit more?
Yeah, come on.
Can you hear a little bit more?
Yeah.
I'm blessed. Can you handle this a little bit more?
Ooh, yeah.
The other thing about the text that messed me up was it specifically said it was his right hand.
Y'all.
It was his
right hand.
Yes.
Whatever the Bible wants to deal with. The left hand deals with strategy and accuracy.
Yes.
But when you deal with the right hand, the right hand is the hand of power. Y'all not hollering back at me again. The right hand is the hand of power.
Yes.
Doing it this
This is what happened last week. Walked up on broken conditions. I didn't know.
You used to sing.
Come on.
Before you had your aneurysm, you used to sing.
Oh, Jesus, Jesus, yes. Hallelujah. Yes, Lord.
Oh, Lord, I wish I had a church in here tonight.
Yes.
The lady
got
the microphone. She said, well, y'all, I haven't done this in some years now. I haven't been able to. So I got to think of me a song. She walked the floor for a few moments. Next thing you know, a sound started coming out. She went to singing a song.
Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah.
I can't honestly tell you what the song was. I forgot now. But it really didn't matter to me. I'm watching somebody who had four strokes and an aneurysm do something she couldn't do before. But that wasn't the shout. Y'all ready for a shout?
Yes.
While she was singing,
yes,
she started walking back and forth like this.
Yes.
She kept singing a little longer.
Yes, Lord.
And she started.
Yes.
She kept singing a little longer. She, now, see, here's the deal. I'm not the healer.
That's right.
Amen. That's right.
Sure
right.
Not.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
So I don't put it on myself to try and do this. It isn't by accident that I was on my way here and God talked to me and said, you got to preach this tonight. Now I know some of y'all in here, y'all got blessed by the word tonight. Let me see if you got blessed by the word. If it was your word tonight,
yes.
But guess what? Y'all were just eavesdropping on her word. Y'all were just eavesdropping on her word. Now, here's what I'm praising up to believe, Paul. If God could send a message like that, Sandy, look, I want you to see this. Hold on. Let me pull this thing back. Yes, should say right there. I want Sandy to see this. Look how many notes are on my page.
Praise
Jesus. Do you see anything about a stroke on there?
Nope.
Yes. Hallelujah.
I'm going to show y'all. Look. This is all the notes I had tonight. For that whole message. Yeah. You see anything about a stroke on there?
Nope.
You see anything? Obviously, God has something to say.
Yes, Lord.
So you know what?
Thank you, Lord. Jesus.
I'm just gonna go with the word of God tonight.
Yes, hallelujah.
And I'm gonna tell Darla.
Amen.
Stretch out.
Hallelujah.
Yes. Uh-oh.
You gonna praise him or not? Yeah.